We're going to continue our discussion of language models, focusing today on neural language models. And neural language models are particularly important not just because they work better than normal probabilistic language models that we've talked about before, but because they are important tools for doing other natural language processing tasks. But before you can talk about neural language models, you have to talk about Muppets. And the University of Maryland has a deep connection to Muppets and neural language models. So the history of Muppets, who, if you're not familiar with the term, Muppets are hand puppets developed by Jim Henson, a University of Maryland graduate, Bachelor of Science, 1960, pictured here with Kermit, his creation, in front of the Stamp Student Center at the University of Maryland in College Park. Neural language models also have a connection to the University of Maryland. One of the first neural language models, and the one that began the Muppet naming craze, was ELMO. One of the authors on that ELMO paper was Mohit Iyer, my former student, who then became a postdoc at the Allen Institute for Artificial Intelligence, where he worked on a team with many people who developed ELMO. The probably best known neural language model is BERT, continuing the Muppet naming trend. The first author on the BERT paper was Jacob Devlin, who graduated the University of Maryland in 2009. And we'll talk more about why Muppets in a second, but first let's talk about why neural language models are such a big deal. They're not just for predicting words. Just like how we talked about WordTVEC as an important tool for representation, neural language models create even better representations. WordTVEC gives you one vector per word. The nice thing about neural language models is that you now have a representation of a word in context. So this means that I took the dog for a walk. Dog in that sentence has a different representation from I bought a hot dog at Coney Island. And these sorts of things can incorporate differences in how they're used. And it goes even further than that. We'll talk about how fine-tuning lets you use these representations as a starting point to do even better for the task that you, in particular, care about. Why Muppets? Why Muppets? So it's not just that Muppets are awesome, though they are. The paper that got everything rolling was arguably the ELMO paper. Mohit, a University of Maryland graduate, is among many of the authors here on this paper, and they called this model ELMO because it's embeddings from language models. And this worked really well. It was a big leap forward. Having these contextual representations really did seem to help. And everybody after that wanted to name their neural language models after a Muppet. One of the reasons that these neural language models have taken on such a big role in natural language processing is that you can do fine-tuning on these models. So we talked about this at a high level. What does it actually mean when, say, you fire up PyTorch? So you train a language model. And this could be a language model as simple as an LSTM, where you take the hidden layer of LSTM and try to predict the next word. So given the start of the sentence, predict open. Given open, try to predict A. Given A, try to predict bank. Given the sentence, open a bank. And you can take that model that takes an input sentence and computes hidden layer representations to predict words, and then swap out your training objective. Instead of trying to predict the next word, you're now going to try to predict whether a sentence has positive or negative sentiment. So, for instance, this is important for reviews. You want to know whether a sentence has a positive sentiment, they like a movie, or they don't. So why does this work? Why is it that fine-tuning works so well given the neural language modeling task. The nice thing is that many other natural language processing tasks that you might care about can be turned into something that looks like a fill-in-the-blank type question. Language models do this on their own, but you can repurpose the internal weights of the model, the representations, to do the tasks that you really care about, even if you don't necessarily care about language modeling. And the nice thing about language modeling is that it doesn't require a lot of expensive annotated data. You just need a bunch of text, and thanks to the internet, we can get tons of that almost for free. So let's take a look at some tasks, how they might be turned into a fill-in-the-blank exercise. So you could have a sentence, the burrito made me sick, and then you could imagine, well, let's fill in the blank, so I think that it's blank. And is it good or bad that fills in the blank with higher probability? Whichever one it is, that's your answer, and that becomes the result of your sentiment analysis task. Another common NLP application is entailment. Given two sentences, does the second logically follow from the first? So John married Lisa, thus Lisa is John's wife. If thus has high probability in this context, then the second sentence is entailed. If you can fill in the blank with a contradictory word negating the second sentence, then it's a contradiction. For question answering, you can turn the question, who was the first president of the United States, into the first president of the United States was blank, and neural language models trained on enough text can fill in the blank with the answer to that question. For other tasks, it's not quite so obvious that they can be turned into a fill-in-the-blank style question, but fine-tuning still seems to work. So just as an aside, I'm not saying that you actually want to create these templates, although sometimes when you see people playing around with GPT-3, they do this. What I'm saying is that the same models, the same representations, are useful for these tasks, and one of the reasons you can think that they would be successful is that you can turn many NLP tasks into fill-in-the-blank style questions. What goes into modern, and I'm recording this in 2020, things may have changed by the time you listen to this, neural language models. So the first thing is that these models should be bidirectional. So if you just use a standard LSTM or RNN, you have this forward feeding effect. The context of a word depends not just on the stuff that came before it, but after. And so this was one of the big insights of ELMO, that in essence, you have two language models, one going left to right and one going right to left. And each of these will have two hidden layers for every word. So you can represent open by the forward LSTM hidden state and the backward LSTM hidden state. And that becomes your embedding. You can feed that into your favorite model and use this as a better alternative to the one-size-fits-all word vectors that you get from Word2Vec or Glove or any of the other models that give you one vector per word or per word type, to be more specific. Here, we're looking at per word token representations. So open in one sentence, open a bank might have a different representation than open a box. Another big innovation was transformers. Transformers are a very specific neural model component. You can think of this as kind of like a Lego. It has a big attention layer. Everything gets then fed forward into a feed-forward network. And this now gives you a different way of representing words. So instead of in a BILSTM where just the immediate neighbors have an effect on the word, of course, you can have longer range dependencies, but that requires the LSTM to keep everything that it needs around, passing it through the memory cells from cell to cell to cell. Instead, the transformer has this attention vector that lets you look over the entire sentence. And this allows you to capture longer range dependencies. And the nice thing about this is that it can do things that correspond to your specific task or that correspond to things that we think are linguistically important. Here you have it's a pronoun taking on representations influenced not just on its antecedent, in this case law, but also the thing that it's modifying, application. And the attention encodes this information. There's even been work showing that you have good correlations with the kind of linguistic structures that people have laboriously coded by hand, but we don't have to do that. These models seem to be able to capture this independently. Another big innovation of neural language models is the training objective. Traditional language models, you have a context and you try to predict the next word. BERT did something a little bit different that seems to work well. Instead of trying to predict the next word, you try to predict masked words from a sentence. So you pretend that you don't know about 15% of the sentence, and then you try to predict the missing words. So this forces the model to be robust to missing context. We've talked about dropout before. You can think about this as encouraging the same sort of robustness and representation. Another innovation in how these models were trained was next sentence prediction. So in addition to trying to predict local things within a sentence, you also want to try to capture how the sentence might fit into a larger document. So given the sentence, the man went to the store, is the next sentence, he bought a gallon of milk, or is it penguins are flightless? If the model can reliably predict what sentence is next, it's doing a better job of capturing this mid-level coherence from one sentence to the next. Another big innovation that was in the Transformer paper, but extended into the BERT paper, was the use of very specific encodings. So let's look at all of the neat things that are going on in here. So one thing that you'll notice is that you don't just have individual tokens, you have word parts. So instead of playing, you have play and ing split into different word parts. You have, as usual, embeddings for each of the tokens. And so this is the same thing that we had from word to vec, nothing new there. But you also have different segment embeddings. This grew out of ideas for encoding parts of speech and things like that into their own representations. But BERT took it an additional step by, let's say that you're trying to figure out the answer to a question, and you might have some source sentence from Wikipedia that you found and a question, and you want to figure out what the answer is. You don't want to treat the source sentence and the question the same, so you want to have different embeddings for the segments. So this is the layer in green here, where you have a very specific embedding for the first part of the encoding and a separate embedding for the second part of the encoding. Then you also have position embeddings for the first word piece, the second word piece, the third word piece, and so on, to capture any position specific effects of your input. What's not to love about neural language models? If you're trying to publish in a reputable computational linguistics or natural language processing or machine learning venue, and you're working with language and you don't have a neural language model baseline in your paper, it's probably going to get rejected. And that's for good reason. These models have much higher accuracies than the previous models, vanilla LSTMs, word to vec, logistic regression, that they're replacing. So what's not to love is, can we just forget about everything else and only use these big neural language models? No, and the reason why is because they're pretty darn complicated. It's really hard to understand what's going on. There's a whole subfield of computational linguistics right now called BERTology, trying to understand what these BERT models are doing and what they're capable of, what they're not capable of. And unlike, say, logistic regression, where you can look at the feature weights and the data and figure out what it's going to do, it's really hard to predict what a BERT model is going to do. And the computation is super expensive. So here we have a graph where the y-axis is performance on a task. The specific performance numbers aren't that important. You could swap out this task for many other tasks. It would look the same. Neural language models are doing better than anything else. The x-axis is how much computational power you need to get that performance. And it looks like you have a big jump from ELMO to these big neural language models. And that's true. And you pay a little bit of a computational cost. So this was about 5 years ago, and fantastic. We're doing much better on these tasks. And things progressed in the last half decade. We had XLNet and Roberta doing much more computation for not that much more performance. And today we have Albert, which broke the Muppet naming trends, and it's doing just a teensy bit better for a huge computational cost. And is it worth it? I don't know. But the takeaway that I would give for anyone starting out is not to jump in whole hog and try to use BERT large. You shouldn't start with that. Basic problems can and should still be solved with simpler models. My personal recommendation would be to start with logistic regression. You will have mistakes in your data. I can't predict what those mistakes will be, but you'll swap the labels, you'll have tokenization issues, you'll have bad annotations, you'll forget to load a file. And these sorts of mistakes are much easier to catch with logistic regression than something as inscrutable as BERT. And BERT is so good that it can sometimes fool you into thinking that you haven't made a mistake when you have. BERT is so good that it can make predictions even with limited data, and you might not be learning much on your fine-tuning for stupid reasons, but it's really hard to tell. Even though it's important that you know how to use BERT and how to fine-tune it on the tasks that you care about, I would never start with BERT for an entirely new task. You should start with things that are simple and that are easy for you to understand and that don't burn a lot of electricity and thus a lot of carbon. If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.